EP, we finna make a hit.
TP, baby.
Hey, nigga come around me acting gangsta, I ain't buying it. He tried to run off, I dumped the Draco where it's buying it. 7-6 to God, I got that name because I'm fine it. Red, we live for life, post on the block, this where I'm dying it. If I shoot my gun, 300 shots gon' come behind it. And if I ever ran, the police probably was behind me. Been in corner, jumping fences, hitting them gates, and now we lit. Who can't do a show up in the city, bitch, this my shit. I'm sliding with 30, told them 50, sent 3 shots and bagged them up. And you remember on that day I shot so fast to 50 bucks. No, you can't be the gang, you know it's hard for us to gain some trust. You wanna be the gang, you gotta sacrifice your life to us. I put a cap up on my head, no, I can't never go out burr. Think my shooter then went down for something, cause all he do is stir. My name spread like the coronavirus, shiesta in the earth. Kick the bitch up out the spot, I call her trying to leave her hurt.
I put a cap up on my head, no, I can't never go out burr. Think my shooter then went down for something, cause all he do is stir. My name spread like the coronavirus, shiesta in the earth. Kick the bitch up out the spot, I call her trying to leave her hurt.
Nigga come around me acting gangsta, I ain't buying it. He tried to run off, I dumped the Draco where it's buying it. 7-6 to God, I got that name because I'm fine it. Red, we live for life, post on the block, this where I'm dying it. If I shoot my gun, 300 shots gon' come behind it. And if I ever ran, the police probably was behind me. Been in corner, jumping fences, hitting them gates, and now we lit. Who can't do a show up in the city, bitch, this my shit. Popping out soon as dark, I've been trapping all through the day. Shooter ready to spar, waiting on they moment to spray. Currently burning these woods, I've been smoking runs to the face. Styrofoam full of mud, my double cup moochie great. Free my niggas from jail, if not, they might escape. Trafficking through the mail, make sure Mac come double tape. Pockets almost obese, I ain't trying to get them in shape. Might pop out in the hood, I'm familiar with all the J's. Slamming shit every day, bitch, we come from catching them plays. Catches that down bad, I'ma get them up out the way. Hit for like 35, call them popping shit in the A. Told them don't make a move, it's like 60 up in his drink. Nigga come around me acting gangsta, I ain't buying it. He tried to run off, I dumped the Draco where it's buying it. 7-6 to God, I got that name because I'm fine it. Red, we live for life, post on the block, this where I'm dying it. If I shoot my gun, 300 shots gon' come behind it. And if I ever ran, the police probably was behind me. Been in corner, jumping fences, hitting them gates, and now we lit. Who can't do a show up in the city, bitch, this my shit.
Whole bitty bitch. Brrr. Who can't do it? Hey, 60 shots up in the chop, trying to hit 30, nigga. Hey, I'm big shots that I get dirty with you.
Shooting they fled. Shawty pulled up shooting, they were trying to fake dead. Fuck up, let me touch a little bread. Get too mad and I pay for some blood to be shed. Yeah, fuck your gang, you heard what I said. Or you cross me, I'm asleep on the bunk bed. Put a Drake up, I take the carbon instead. Too geeked up, I'm crossing all with the men. Free cup, he threw up on the lick, he was scared. He step on shit, be quiet, no said. Shoot first the model, you know how we pay. Them hollow to hungry, they ate up his leg. I was just dropping shit, look where it led. Now I'm in the hills, I can't spell where we stayed. I can't go out like I'm Tony, you can't sneak up on me. I got the whole world in my hands. Sad how we treat the opponents, I'm still undefeated when we talking body and bands. Nip like the Memphis, I slide when I land. You try to spin through, had the body your man. All of my bitches be too slammed then. When I sick them on you, they baiting you in. Been with the coolin' kid on the FN. I knew I was gon' catch a body at 10. Gotta hop out on feet every time that we spin. Wanna get with my gang called Delta, get in. Tryna reach for my chain, you all Memphis a mid. They shot long right, turn the step with the six. First every time, better XIT. Got a day going out like Pac on B. Everybody around me buying green. Knew we big C gang, what the fuck you mean? Everybody on my team. Still post on the blog like I'm y'all me. Home hard hat with the long sleeve. In the road, road truck, Mars, I was a freak. If I wanna dead, I just pay this shit cheap. You one in the head, no LA paper key. Peep your gun, shit weak. Can't running on me, I'm too slimy and neat. Hey, shout out to TP, he cooked up the beef. Some tears in the hills, I need to try that with me. Still front line, real beef. Put on the slider and they couldn't eat shit. Sleeping them clothes on them, my technique. Gotta buy back the block cause I run concrete. Everybody around me see red. Everybody around me got one in the head. Shots they pulled up shooting, they fled. Shots pulled up shooting, they was trying to fake dead. Oh, thug, let me touch a little bread. Get too mad and I pay for some blood to be shed. Fuck your gang, you heard what I said. Oh, you cross me, I'ma sleep on the bunk bed. Drake up, I take the carbon instead. Too geeked up, I'm crossing Zaw with the man. Free cup, he threw up on the lick, he was scared. He step on shit, be quiet enough said. Street first the model, you know how we play. Them hollow too hungry, they ate up his leg. I was just dropping shit, look where it led. Now I'm in the hills, I can't spell where we stayed. No, no, can't spell where we stayed. Brrr. Big brrr, brrr.
We Japanese still. You getting cooked in front of your family like a Japanese meal. It's y'all soup the hibachi, and none of you niggas can stop me, but can't help but watch me. Shari says no audio. Let me make sure. Let me see. Let me play it back. She says no audio. Did we get blocked on the audio? I play the music. Let me see. Didn't happen last time. Let me check real quick. I can always just look at myself live. Oh, Safiq says audio is cool on his side. So if I go.
Let me check real quick. I can always just look at myself live.
Let me go back. Yeah, the audio is playing. We good, Shari. Maybe it's on your end. But we in here, man. We about to finish this book. Last chapter in the conclusion. You guys are going to enjoy this chapter. The other 5 and 4 was more technical about the blades trade and the arts and ivory spoons and stuff of that nature. So maybe this chapter right here would be something you guys would be a lot more interested in because it's dealing with the evolution of identity. So at the onset, when the European Jews, the Sephardic Jews, Amsterdam Jews, and Dutch Jews, when they first get to the west coast of Africa and they begin to mix with the locals, they convert some of the locals, they start to merge with the locals, they start picking up African ritual traditions and becoming like the locals, they had no issue with skin color. There was no racial hierarchy in regards to physical properties and physical appearances. But now this chapter covers when the idea of whiteness and, you know, hyphenated whiteness begins to be pervasive in Europe, which, again, when these Jews go back to Amsterdam, they start to adopt these talking points because they want to be accepted by the locals of Amsterdam and Europe and Northern Europe and whatnot. In the United Provinces and Netherlands. Shout out to the Netherlands. They just beat Argentina, by the way. But with that being said, so this is what the main goal of this chapter is trying to achieve, is to show the reader how that they went from a non-racial hierarchy system that was very inclusive to a pretty much white-only club by the 17, 18 centuries. So it's good to really understand this history and the effects of ideology. And I tell you guys all the time, it's not people that are the problem. It's the ideologues. It's the ideologies that are being taught that are the problem. This is why I would never stand with Afrocentrics. I would never stand with BHI. I would never stand with Abos because their ideologies are bad. Sonnetta and Garfield's ideologies are bad. Most of the reason why they have problem with Jews, reason why they have problems with anything outside of the African-American context is because their negative views and ideology on white people. So, you know, a lot of people, I've heard people say, you just want to connect to white people. I am connected to white people, whether you like it or not, whether it's because of the culture I choose to practice, which is a form of Judaism, or whether it's my genes. My genes are connected to people that you would call and deem white. Many of these people that we're discussing tonight, today, and what we have been discussing when reading this book, a lot of them are E1B1B. There's a good percentage of them that are E1B1B. Those are our brothers. and some could be E1B1A as well, it's because they're described as white does not determine their haplogroup. And as we said, even the Wolofs could have also been, the Wolofs and many of these West African peoples could also have been the offspring of Levantine Fulmars 3,000 years ago that made the trek to the current location in West Africa. And we've been saying this over and over again, it's highly, highly possible to be the case because we can see the genetic signatures within the DNA of the contemporary populace.
It's possible. It's possible. It's possible. It's possible. It's possible.
So, yeah, we actually took our time out to read and understand this. Like the old adage says, understand is what thou readest. And also, and all I getting, get it from understanding. So, with that being said, matter of fact, real quick, before we get there, let's just go to that paper real quick. I wasn't planning on doing this. Let's just go to the paper. I believe it's the YDNA of Cape Verde. And there's another one about Portugal. YDNA lineage is Cape Verde, 2003. Is it the 2003 one? I'm going off memory, y'all. Yeah, the one that was done in 2003. So, as you guys can see, a lot of these Portuguese Jews that ended up in Cape Verde, they do have some of their DNA there. Look, so this is the Y chromosome lineages in Cabo Verde Islands, witnesses the diverse geographic origin of its first male settlers. And we do know Jews were there. We even read about it, that Jews played a pivotal role in Cape Verde, right? So, with that being said, it talks about the Y chromosome haplogroup composition of the population of the Cabo Verde archipelago. And then it gives you some of them, right? Of course, a lot of Eurasian IJKR1 is there, but you also have J lineages there because you haven't, we know Jews are there. Moreover, a high frequency of gene lineage in Cabo Verdeans relates them more closely to a population in the Middle East and probably provides the first genetic evidence of the legacy of the Jews. In addition, the considerable proportion, 20% of E3B, M81 lineages indicates a possible gene flow from the Middle East or Northeast Africa, which at least partly could be ascribed to the Sephardic Jews. So these E markers, Yap gang, Yap, was involved with Sephardic Jew migration. So we're dealing with them as well. All right, so with that, let's go to the book. Let's get into the meat and potatoes of tonight. He said, when there's so many, sometimes the indiscriminate fully spray is needed. Booker Tove. Shalom, Safiq. All right, so with that being said, let's get straight to the book, man. You know how we rocking, man. We finish our meals here. Eat your food. We finish our meals here. Like I said, we gonna finish this book. Oh, my bad. You don't want meat and potatoes? Okay, let me get you a big steak omelet. Big steak omelet with green and red peppers. You know what I'm saying? With three pancakes on the side. let's blow this up. Shalom to the family, man. Shalom to the avid readers out there. You know, there's certain people that claim they read these books or reference these books. And as you read it, you can tell they didn't. So anyway, let's go to shout out to Rob Bourne. He did stop by last night and made a statement claiming to give me this book. But, you know, since Rob Bourne was here last night, let me give him a shout out real quick.
Africans that came to America came from Lisbon and Portugal.
Are you denying that we had ancestors who were Hebrew Israelites?
Yes. And what I mean by that, by bloodline, by faith, no, because we can prove that we have ancestors that could have been part of the first Hebrews.
Okay. We can prove that we have ancestors that could have been part of the first Hebrews. Shout out to my brother, Rob Busy. Rob Busy in the building. All right, so back to the book, y'all. Anyway, like I said, man, these brothers know what's up, man. It's very hard.
It's possible.
With that being said, chapter six, the latter years, the later years, merchant mobility and evolution of identity. As I stated before, we're going to be dealing with how racism crept in and affected these communities that were in Amsterdam, that were in the United Provinces, that were in Dutch territories, and also in West Africa. They're starting to bring in these ideas of whiteness and racial hierarchy that's starting to be, you know, pick up steam in the European mainland. So that affected the Jew population, the Jewish congregations, and how they saw their darker members of the congregations. So let's get right to it. The establishment of two communities of Jewish merchants on Senegal's Petit Côte before 1612 is abundantly detailed, both in the archives of the Lisbon Inquisition and in the complementary information preserved in the notary records of Amsterdam's municipal archives. The subsequent economic transformations that affected commerce at Joal and Porte d'Aile are also illustrated in these records. But the individual itineraries of the men whose early lives took them from Lisbon to Amsterdam and on to Senegal are often more difficult to trace. In the following pages, we situate the subsequent evolution of Joal and Porto de Aile within the broader context of Portuguese trade with the Cape Verde Islands and within the Guinea of Cape Verde. As the evolution relates both to increasing Northern European involvement in Guinea trade and to changing relations with local Senegambian rulers. We also address the rather complex question, what, if any, was the nature of the two communities' involvement in the Atlantic slave trade? By 1620, several of the early Sephardic merchants on the Petit Côte had returned to Amsterdam. What factors occasioned their decision to leave West Africa? Had they from the beginning envisioned Joal and Porte d'Aile as only temporary homes? The return to the Netherlands led us to reflect in the following pages upon another closely related question of enduring historical significance. Several of the original Portuguese settlers on the Petit Côte, as well as some of their offspring and accompanying household members, are described as Africans or of mixed origin. Might the later lives of these men in Amsterdam provide insight into the incipient attitudes toward people of African or mixed Euro-African ancestry in early and mid-17th century Amsterdam? Early attitudes towards race in Amsterdam have recently been studied by several scholars. Does the history of the Sephardic Jews in Senegal alter in any way the historical picture of the Jewish attitudes toward Africans and individuals of mixed ancestry in early modern Europe? Several caveats are in order here. The very use of the term racial attitudes is to some extent an anachronism, for it tends to impute to people living four centuries ago an acceptance of categories and of their presumed associated sociocultural characteristics that had only just begun to be articulated in Northern Europe. So real quick side note here, this is what I was saying earlier, that a lot of this race stuff was brand new. They didn't have that idea. So they were very inclusive at first. They did not look at their children, their own damn children, as being other. Or racial others at that time, because this doctrine had was not cemented yet. It's a very young doctrine that a lot of Afrocentrics choose to go by. You know, the racial identity logic that they use. That's why they say you can't be Jews, because oh, look at you, you're black. You know, that comes from Europe. Doesn't even come from Africa, right? But they call themselves Afrocentrics anyway. Even the use of words such as you're African or black to discuss 16th or early 17th century attitudes may impart a modern bias to the historical interpretation. Furthermore, these categories and their ascribed characteristics were not necessarily the same in Portugal and the Netherlands. A full analysis and treatment of this topic is not the central aim of the present study. However, there were African and Euro-African members of the Portuguese communities on the Petit Côte and later in Amsterdam. Hence, issues such as the relationship of Jewish identity to what is today called race and the incorporation into the Sephardic social and religious community of individuals of Euro-African or even African background. And this is what we were discussing. These issues arise. Why? Because the adoption of the racial hierarchical system, right? And it says, Individuals of your African or even African background are relevant to this study. The small size of the Amsterdam Portuguese community, especially through the 1630s, renders even these few cases significant to the historical study of the role and the treatment of these earliest your African members of a minority religious community. From the earliest years of Portuguese Jewish settlement in João and Portugal, there was a constant coming and going between Petitcoat and the Dutch port of Rotterdam. Already in November of 1610, Diogo Vaz de Sousa and Estavo were reported in Dutch notary records to have traveled back to the Netherlands. Yet it is clear from Inquisition sources that shortly thereafter, they both returned to Senegal and they identified themselves as Moradores dos Ditos Portos Daye em Joia. Dwellers of the above-named ports of Porto Real and Jola, respectfully. Parenthetically, here as on numerous other occasions, the Dutch commercial records and the Portuguese Inquisition sources correspond so closely as to form a practically seamless web of information. And an Inquisition witness effectively confirmed the Dutch notary when he referred to Diogo Vaz de Sousa, the younger brother of Felipe de Sousa, who has been to Flanders a few times and returned to Guinea. Two other members of the Portuguese trading community, Luis Fernandez Duarte and Gaspar Fernandez, two individuals who were living on the Petitcoat in 1610, both later traveled back and forth to Northern Europe. In 1615, Gaspar Fernandez was in Amsterdam, where he held the equivalent of power of attorney for his sister in a business deal. Diogo Vaz de Sousa, however, was still living in the Cape Verde in 1619 when he was responsible for loading the ship de Suarte Beer, which have arrived from Amsterdam. Of course, the fact that other merchants are not cited in surviving archives as having traveled does not rule out the possibility that they too made visits back to Amsterdam while living in Senegal. Assessing how common it was for the Portuguese of the Petitcoat to travel to Amsterdam is rendered even more difficult by the fact that there appear to have been several individuals with the same name in the Portuguese community of Amsterdam. A significant fact reflected in the early Dutch records is a passing reference to a third trading escale on the Petitcoat. This is the village of Recife, or Arecipo, better known by its later name of Refisque. In March 1611, two vessels, Fortune and Hope, were freighted out by Gaspar Nunes and Antonio Nobre, alias Antonio Nunes. The boats were to sail first to Palma, where they were to stock wine and then to proceed to Porto Real, João and Arecipo. This may be the earliest reference to Refisque, which was to become home to the third Jewish community in Senegal and the only one to last into the second half of the 17th century. Evocation of Refisque in the later history of Europeans on the Petitcoat raises the issue of the volatility of trading relationships everywhere along the Senegalese coast. Like their Portuguese and Dutch contemporaries, the Jewish traders were dependent upon maintaining good relations with local African rulers. Changing alliances could lead to decline or relocation of the trading communities that were dependent upon these relationships. In the case of Refisque, a second factor was added. Intra-European competition for the control of nearby Goree Island, their Portuguese conquest led to the temporary disappearance of the synagogue of Refisque. Ultimately, the ivory and hide trades were to prove crucial to the existence of João and Porto Real as commercial escales. Commerce on the Petitcoat was not, however, limited to locally procured goods. The two villages apparently served as clearinghouses of escales, especially for hides and ivory, but also for wax. From all of Guinea and even from elsewhere in West Africa, a report of the Fleming João Consoal in February of 1614 described the communities. 1520 houses of Portuguese Jews from various places out of interest for commerce, and it is an escale for all of the goods that are traded and collected from the whole of the coast of Guinea, Congo, and Angola, which they sent to Holland. Real quick commentary here. As was noted in the prior chapter and the chapter before that, they did not just sell slaves. They also sold other goods, as we just read, right? It says, while this account suggests that João and Porto Real were collection points for the entire range of goods acquired in West and Western Central Africa, Dutch records of the items actually brought back to Amsterdam indicate that the range of goods, though not of geographical origins, was more limited. Through the second decade of the century, vessels returning from Petitcote regularly brought quantities of ivory and animal hides. Additional items, if any are mentioned at all, are simply referred to as other goods. To our knowledge, at least in the official record from Amsterdam, no mention is made of gold, nor of rice, nor of slaves. Of course, slaves would have been shipped directly to the New World, which could explain their absence from any finding records in Holland. Inquisition records allow us to understand Sephardic trade and strategies of survival in the way they were linked to the wider Atlantic trade. In November of 1614, the same witness, Consuel, reports on clandestine commerce between Lisbon and Northern Europe. He describes Jewish involvement with Northern European trading partners in the Atlantic. Sao Tome and Brazil were on the route of Dutch ships. According to Consuel's detailed report, the same Dutch vessels that carried new Christians escaping from Portugal to Holland also carried merchandise from Brazil and Sao Tome by the ways of the Açores and Canaries, and by the way them, the islands, they go and come. Some of the Dutch families had sugar mills in Brazil. Indeed, as Daniel Swieczynski observes in his History of the Sephardic Community in Amsterdam, the first Portuguese merchants to settle in Amsterdam were merchants who had been most actively engaged in the Brazil trade. Relatives who remained in Lisbon became trading partners of these new Christians. This means that after 1621, the formerly legal activities were now pursued illegally. Consuel implies that what allowed this was the truce between the Netherlands and the Iberian crown. But he warns that once the truce ended, the Jews might become lords of Brazil. He adds, and that the Jews have a synagogue on the mainland of Cape Verde between two large rivers between Cape Roxo and Cape Verde, as I have reported. The juxtaposition of these comments implies a link between Sephardic commerce in the Atlantic and the establishment of the Petitcote communities. Consuel considers them as part of the same movement. This report helps to elucidate the activities of the Petitcote families, such as Rodriguez de Viaga, who maintained trade interests both in Brazil and on the Guinea coast. The Dutch could acquire merchandise from Brazil, also from Guinea, by way of Lisbon. This is a crucial point. Lisbon remained an important port for these activities at least until 1621, when the truce ended and a generalized state of maritime war in the Atlantic began. Evidence in the Lisbon archives show that some Jews living in Amsterdam maintained commercial connections with both Guinea, Upper and Lower, and the island of Sao Tome, as well as with Brazil, at least as late as 1623, in the year Sebastião, who had lived in Amsterdam since 1611 and was most probably a relative of Samuel Rodriguez Pinhel, one of the synagogue Jews, was a merchant in Brazil and Guinea. At the same date, another member of the Sephardic community, Manuel de Campos, had returned to Amsterdam after many years in Sao Tome. The link to Sao Tome may have had antecedents as early as 1585. At that time, maritime connections between the island, Angola, and Northern Europe were not submitted to tight control of the Portuguese authorities. Furthermore, a long denunciation presented to the Inquisition of Lisbon reports that public Jews were living in the forest island of Sao Tome. Sao Tome was part of a Jewish escape route that continued to Flanders and Flemish ships, and from there to Venice. Further evidence of direct connections between Portuguese/Dutch settlers in João in Porto de Alva in Sao Tome comes in an intriguing manner. The same Inquisition report from 1614 that describes trade between the Petitcote and Congo and Angola also includes the following accusation. And the aforementioned Dutchman tells me that a Jew had told them that no old Christians are to be found any longer in these places, because they, the Jews, have certain poisonous crabs from Sao Tome. From these, they confection a liquid that they know how to adjust according to how long they want the person to live, to whom they give this concoction, and in this manner they kill the Christians when and as they wish. So real quick, this is propaganda to demonize the Jews. You guys should be familiar with that, especially with the time we live in now and the yay coverage and what's going on with Ron Dalton and his book, and how Afrocentrics love to kind of poo-poo on the Jewish community. So it's kind of funny reading this. It's always been a thing, right? But these are, just Europeans doing it. Now, in today's time, you see Europeans, you see everybody doing this, right? But the thing is, back then, and the ramifications And the consequences for this were huge because this could get people killed, right? Especially during this time. Oh, you saying the Jews are going around, you know, taking poisonous, making poisonous potions and you know, giving it to people and killing off Europeans, you know, that might incite violence, right? So as we'll see what happened after this. It says, if this report is to be believed, and it is hardly credible, then the settlers on the Petit Coat had sufficiently close relations with some of the Jewish inhabitants of Sao Tome to have learned to manufacture this poison and presumably to acquire a supply of the deadly crabs. The men of Joao and Porto de Isle had sailed from the Netherlands, but they all begun their peregrinations in Portugal, and they had immigrated in order to practice their religion without having to fear that their own lives would be sacrificed at an act of faith. Now, old Christian merchants purportedly risked their own lives if they stayed in these ports. Crab poison, or the Christians' fear of poison, would have served as a means of protection for the members of two trading communities who scant years before had been threatened by the visit of delegation from the Bishop of Cape Verde, seeking to convince the Bursin to turn them all over to the Inquisition. The irony of the situation in which the Jews had turned the tables on their persecutors would not have been lost on the men of Joao and Porto de Alho. The Inquisition both created and thrived on the atmosphere of suspicion and fear. In this world that they had created, the agents of the Holy Office were also prone to become victims of the very sentiments they fostered against among their victims. Accusations of Jews murdering Christians have a long history in medieval and early modern Europe. From the oft-repeated myth of the sacrifice of Christian children for the Passover Seder to blaming epidemics upon Jews, for example, the Black Death in Strasbourg in 1348 and 1349, periodically, these accusations led to massacres of local Jewish communities. Of course, the story of the crab poison is reminiscent of these accusations that Jews ritually murdered Christians. In 17th century Iberia, the climate of heightened suspicion engendered by the Holy Office encouraged further accusations of murder against Jews. Certainly, coastal Senegal's climate is conducive to the spread of many deadly microbes, ranging from malaria to typhoid to dysentery. Although one must admit that there is a certain attraction to the idea that the Jewish merchants of Joao and Porto de Alho could have protected themselves from the Inquisition, removed potential competitors, and perhaps gained retribution for the past suffering by administering poison water, it's hardly credible that there were any poison crabs. João Soeiro, as a contractor, the slave trade from Upper Guinea. So I know many Afrocentric, they probably just jumped to this portion of the book because this is what they want to talk about, right? The Jewish involvement in slavery, right? It says here, the fear and suspicion fostered by the Inquisition affected not only its potential victims, but also its own operatives. Informants for the Holy Office themselves often potential targets of investigation, and in some instances already under arrest, had reason to exaggerate their accusations, either to deflect suspicion from themselves or for other motives. Inquisition reports are thus prone to exaggeration. Those reports that assert illegal commercial activity are also subject to distortion out of economic self-interest because informants were frequently reporting on their competitors. Again, you know, the CEOs of Burger King are not going to advertise for McDonald's, right? This is just common sense. These Portuguese and these inquisitors, they were upset that these Jews were, you know, making so much ground and so much money off of the trade and pretty much dominating some aspects of the trade as well, as we read in earlier chapters. So they're trying to do everything in their power to get rid of their competitors. It says here, consequently, in the absence of corroborating evidence, such reports have to be read skeptically. A critical perspective is particularly warranted in the case of allegations that were collected against João Soeiro, a new Christian who was the contractor for Guinea of Cape Verde from 1609 to 1614. And again, new Christian means a Jew that converted to Christianity. It says here, although he was never formally charged by the Holy Office, Soedo was the subject of a long investigation and a report dating from 1613, reiterated in 1621, that accusing him of using his royal monopoly to favor new Christian merchants, including his own close relatives. Soedo was accused of having permitted illegal commerce as part of the trade that he effectively controlled, along with his hand-picked lieutenant, his factor in Cachao, Baltasar Lopez. Indeed, as contractor, Soedo had his own factor who could authorize this illegal trade. The document accuses Soedo of facilitating the entry of Dutch Jews into the trade with the rivers of Guinea. Specifically, he is charged with inviting his brother, who was living in the Netherlands, to send three ships to the Petit Coast. These vassals brought it at least nine men, most of them members of the Jewish community, to the coast during the period 1611-1612. The reporter continues, those who do not profess their Jewishness in this kingdom now openly and publicly proclaim their Jewishness. Since João Soedo is the contractor and they arrive with their ships from Flanders, which they fill with goods that they deliver and return loaded again, to the great prejudice of His Majesty's trade and against the service of God. The Dutch and their Portuguese partners were in fact able to siphon off much of the trade in hides, wax, and ivory. Soedo is further accused of authorizing his factor and writing to ensure that all of the ivory collected on the Petit Coast should be loaded on ships of Antonio Nunes and Lorenzo Francisco sailing from Holland. In addition, Inquisition informants observed that as long as Soedo held the contract for Guinea, many ships from France and England traveled to that port. And that, in this instance, however, it does appear that the contractor is being blamed for the loss of Portugal's commercial monopoly on the Petit Coast, a development that clearly was a result of factors far beyond the control of any individual. If the freedom of the trade of Soedo's contract allowed was decisive to the development of the Jewish communities of the Petit Coast, his successors, Antonio Fernandez and the Capitão Moore at Cachao, Baltasar Pereira, maintained the general status quo that favored the Jewish traders. In 1617, the fact was accused. He allowed many launches to go to the coast to trade with infidels and with Jews who lived there, and the said launches carried much wax, ivory, gold, silver, and amber. And when they returned to Cachao, they gave their debts to the said factors because he allows them to do this. Inquisition documents suggest that Soedo was able to profit from the increase in international competition that brought English and French vessels to Rufisque. Rufisque is situated at the place where the northern reaches of the Petit Coast join the Cape Verde Peninsula. Inquisition informants provided some details of the coastal trade from Rufisque. The factor there had official written authorization from Soedo that empowered him to receive merchandise from elsewhere on the coast. The goods brought to Rufisque were then loaded onto a ship belonging to Soedo's brother, Diogo Lopez, who lived in the Netherlands. Presumably, this coastal trade could also include goods left at Rufisque by English and French merchants to be exchanged for hides, wax, and ivory brought by a small boat from further south along the coast. In the document, João Soedo is accused of having facilitated the export of slaves. The text of the accusation against Soedo regarding the slave trade reads, because in the time of his contract, more than 30 ships sailed directly, some from Seville, others from the city of Lisbon, the latter directly to the Canaries, and from there to the rivers of Guinea, and those from Seville directly to the rivers, and others from the city of the island of Santiago. And the witness knows that each of these ships charges 300, 350, and 400 slaves each year. And he knows this because he has seen it in addition to these ships of the register. Many other ships which have advanced money to the contractor Soedo, along with ships of the register from all which he obtained much profit. If the total number of ships during Soedo's five-year tenure was more than 30, and if indeed each ship transported 300 to 400 slaves each year, the total number of captives would be a minimum of 9,000 and a maximum of 12,000 over the five-year period. This works out at least 1,800 slaves, but probably more than 2,400 slaves annually. These inquisition documents relating to Soedo provide information that is important for the study of the Atlantic slave trade at the beginning of the 17th century. In fact, very little is known about the slave trade from Upper Guinea during the first two decades of the 17th century. As historian David Wheat has observed, between 1601 and 1616, traffic from Upper Guinea appears to simply vanish. In Spanish America, there was a pronounced drop in officially recorded slave imports to Cartagena beginning in 1602. If there was indeed a widespread drop in slave exports from Upper Guinea beginning 8 years before Serrano was named contractor, then the Inquisition charges against him were simply an attempt to find a scapegoat. But these Inquisition charges themselves, along with other sources for Upper Guinea and Cape Verde, suggest that the slave trade was not discontinued during this time. These new slave trade statistics also helped to settle the debate about the magnitude of early 17th century slave exports from Upper Guinea. In their introduction to the revised online database, Eltis and Richardson asked how many of the early voyages are missing from the records. The answer clearly is contraband voyages are missing, and there were a lot of them. This Inquisition account provides a concrete figure, more than 30 ships over a five-year period, representing between 1,800 and 2,400 or more captives annually shipped from Upper Guinea to the Americas. These numbers are double or even triple Eltis' estimate of 854 annual slave departures from Upper Gambia in the second decade of the 17th century. The difference is even more striking when compared to Antonio Mendez's estimate of Senegambian slave exports to Spanish America for 1601 to 1625. He suggests a total of 9,600 for an annual average of fewer than 400. Our figures are confirmed by the 1615 report of Father Manuel Alvarez, who writes that an average 1,800 slaves were exported each year from Rio de Santo Domingo to Spanish America or the Cape Verde Islands. Furthermore, the order of magnitude 1,800 to 2,400 or more slaves annually from all of Guinea of Cape Verde corroborates earlier scholarship. Stephen Buchan's meticulous study of the ethnic composition of the slave community in the late 16th century Peru, of his estimate of 2,000 to 3,000 slaves annually exported from Upper Guinea, is directly supported by our Inquisition figures. Two, Frederick Bowser's work on the late 16th century Peru, recently contested by Elkins as overestimating the Upper Guinean population, should be reconsidered. Our research implies a significant upward revision for the magnitude of the slave trade from Upper Guinea during the 5 years of Sorrero's contract. The Inquisition report is based on an eyewitness, the captain of the infantry on Santiago Island, and the figures are fairly precise. These numbers are all the more significant because they are in the middle of a period, the first two decades of the 17th century, for which data from the Upper Guinea are rare. Furthermore, the Inquisition witness helps to explain the apparent gap in the records cited by the Transatlantic Slave Trade Database, the second. Most of the slaves during this period were carried as contraband on non-registered vessels. These numbers, therefore, necessitate a significant revision of historians' assessment of the importance of Upper Guinea relative to West Central Africa and the peopling of Spanish America. The Transatlantic Slave Trade Database suggests a radical drop-off in recorded slave vessels leaving Upper Guinea during the period 1611 and 1616. This is intriguing, although there is a two-year time lag relative to Sorrero's tenure as contractor. It is now evident that during Sorrero's tenure as contractor, many vessel slaves sailed surreptitiously to South America. The figures certainly suggest that some of the vessels sailing from Guinea of Cape Verde had as their destination Brazil. Sorrero's activities with regard to the slave trade cannot be blamed for either the apparent but probably illusory perceptuous decline in the slave exports that began in 1602 or for the absence of written information for the entire period. Nevertheless, his tenure in the apparent increased activity by vessels that were not registered and that did not pay duties at the Santiago Island or in Cachao certainly helped to explain the relative lack of official Portuguese records from 1609 to 1614. How reliable are Inquisition charters of sizable illicit slave trade? The Inquisition documents relating to Sorrero are voluminous, but their interpretation raises a problem with credibility of the sources. Does the 1613 report confirmed in 1621 constitute a credible source, or is it evidence of a witch hunt? And how deeply involved, if at all, were the Jewish merchants of Petit Côte in this traffic in human beings? Although Inquisition records attribute the arrival at the Petit Côte of Jews from Amsterdam to Cerreros, encouragement of extra-legal commerce by new Christians and Jewish traders, the informants do not specifically accuse the Jewish merchants of involvement in the Atlantic slave trade. The only statistics the report provides are the 30 ships, each with the capacity of 300 to 400 captives. The settlers at Joal and Puerto de Al are not cited with regard to these slaving ships. Nevertheless, some unnamed Jews are mentioned in the slave trading documents of Manuel Bautista Perez. By contrast, the act of trade in hides and ivory from the Petit Côte is described in detail in Inquisition accounts, and its commerce is confirmed in Father Alvarez's account, as well as in the Dutch notarial archives. Alvarez, for example, estimates annual exports at 50,000 hides and 200 quintals of ivory. While Dutch records provide both specific quantities and precise values of experts for individual shipping voyages. As one specific example, in 1615, Gaspar Fernandez received 500 guilders from the Portuguese merchant Duarte Fernandez, probably his brother, on behalf of a widow whom he represented, for the 3,044 hides he brought back from Guinea on a single vessel in 1611. The Dutch notarial records are, however, practically silent when it comes to slaves. There exists one early reference to the acquisition of captives, the Petit Côte. Interestingly, it involves the same Gaspar Fernandez. In November 1610, Diogo Vaz de Sousa and Estevao sailed from Puerto de Al to Rotterdam on the ship Santiago. The vessel carried four Africans, one of whom had been purchased in Joal, the other three in Puerto de Al. The four were purchased to work in the services of Gaspar Nunes and Gaspar Sanchez, who had financed the voyage. None of these diverse sources directly associate the Sephardic merchants living in Senegal with the slave trade. In 1618, Manuel Perez did acquire slaves from the Jews, but it's not known whether these Jews lived on the Petit Côte or in Cachao. It was not moral qualms, but lack of opportunity that prevented the Jews of Joal and Puerto de Al from engaging in the slave trade. Trade in the use of black slaves will be rationalized, as it was throughout the Cape Verdean Guinean world, as a common practice and activity on the basis of the regional status of Branco. Only Negroes, as we have seen, a category not necessarily connected with actual skin color, could be enslaved. In Senegambia, the slave trade traced the limit of identity flexibility. By providing iron bars in exchange for cloth, these Jews were providing a crucial trade item that enabled other merchants to participate in the slave trade. It seems likely that the Jews of the Petit Côte were only marginally involved in that commerce. Further evidence of this marginality may be reflected in the letter that Luis Fernandez Duarte wrote to the King of Busas. This ruler was one of the largest slave traders on the coast, and he was trading partner of the Portuguese factor at Cachao. Israel's letter proposes a trading partnership and mentions slaves at the top of the list of desired merchandise. But the very fact that he wrote it suggests that this commerce had yet to be established by the traders living at Puerto de Al and Joal. In his letter to the King of Busas, Duarte proposes, if the king agrees to make a deal with him, to send a lunch or small sailing vessel to the mouth of his river, prepared to receive the king's merchandise. Duarte suggests to the ruler, you should bring black boys 12 to 13 years of age and an old black man and women of the appropriate age, ivory and wax, and some gold from the Rio Nunes. Then he lists what he, Luis Duarte, could send from the Petit Côte. Moorish horses and iron bars are the first products mentioned, followed by Dutch cloth, silk, fine cotton, clothing, rolls of cloth, and sculpted glass. Duarte's proposal to purchase captives reflects closely the demographics of the slave trade to Portugal. Antonio Mendes has brilliantly analyzed 16th century slave exports from Arguin. In the trans-Saharan trade, 90% of the slaves were women or boys, and an arguing in the early 16th century. As Mendes showed, nearly 70% of the captives were women, children, or adolescents. The eternal transit of these captives brought to the Sahara was controlled by Berbers and Jews. Joshua Israel's request for women and 12-year-old boys reflecting these demographics suggests that he may have had knowledge of the Jewish slave networks of the Sahara. Israel's letter demonstrates that the petite coat Jews were attempting to enter the slave trade. Significantly, however, this trade, had it been established, would not have passed through Kachau, which was the center for the legal trade on the coast. The king of Busis had business with Kachau, but Duarte was trying to convince him to trade directly with him. Duarte's idea was to have his small boat sail directly from Busis back to Rafiski. As we have seen, at this time, a number of ships carried out illegal trade with the protection of the contractor. Clearly, some of the Jews of the Petit Coat tried to add slaves and other merchandise to their trade in ivory, wax, and skins. Duarte Israel's plan to have his boat sail directly between Busis and Rafiski indicates that he knew he could sell the slaves at this port, presumably to the French and the Dutch merchants who put in at Rafiski. It is conceivable that some of the European merchants had directly expressed to Israel a desire for captives. The Dutch had formally acquired captives on the Petit Coat. When Peter van den Broek arrived at Porto Real in January 1606, there was a slave trade at Joal and Porto Real. But if slaves had been readily available there in 1612, Duarte would not have sought captives from Busis, about 200 kilometers away. Something had interrupted the supply of captives to the Petit Coat. James Webb argues that the 18th century trans-Saharan slave trade from Cayo and other northern Senegambian states was greater than the Atlantic trade. This would certainly have been true in the early 17th centuries. Van den Broek's experience at Joal and Porto Real in 1606 may thus reflect a temporary shift from the primary Saharan market to the secondary Atlantic market. The reason for this shift is not obscure. Between 1603 and 1605, the death of Mulay Ahmad al-Mansur, following an epidemic of plague and by ensuing political chaos in Marrakesh, disrupted trade between Morocco and the Western Sudan. The slaves who, according to Van den Broek, were sold on the Petit Coat in 1606 must have been sent to the secondary market on the coast as a direct result of dynastic events in Morocco. Van den Broek arrived at the Petit Coat at precisely the moment of this temporary disruption in the trans-Saharan slave trade. But by the time that Joshua Israel was trading along the same part of the coast, slaves were no longer available locally. Duarte Israel may, however, have been proposing a very special slave trade, not for the transatlantic commerce, but rather to be traded for the Moorish horses of the Sahara. We know from Almada in the late 16th century, the Wolofs were buying horses from the Moors. The age and gender profiles of the slaves sought by Israel were ideally suited to the Saharan market, suggesting that they may have been intended to be traded for horses. The horses, in turn, would have increased the demand for short swords from the Portuguese to serve as cavalry weapons. If there is no evidence of direct slave trade from the Petit Coat in the period 1608 to 1620, this does not necessarily mean that all members of the Amsterdam's young Jewish community remain uninvolved in that trade. We know that Jacob Pellegrino earlier held enough iron bars on the Petit Coat to be able to provide them to other traders. Iron bars were regularly exchanged for slaves during the 17th century. By 1619, several of the Petit Coat merchants had come to play an important role in Brazil's sugar production. That is the case of Pedro Rodriguez and his brother in Rotterdam and Amsterdam. Manuel Rodriguez's sugar plantations, of course, functioned by means of slave labor. Connections to slave trade were a fundamental part of the Brazilian plantation system. Dynastic and religious changes on the Petit Coat. An important factor ensuring the commercial success and safety of the Jewish settlements in Porto Real and Joal was the protection provided by local Muslim rulers. The Wolof political elite and the coastal polities from the Senegal River south through Cayor were firmly associated with the Muslim faith. In 1616, the Jesuit missionary Father Manuel Alvarez reported that the Wolof kings and their ministers were lettered in Arabic and were observant Muslims. The majority of the Wolof nobility live inland. They maintain among each other the sect of Muhammad. Those who are religious leaders teach Arabic to their sons and prepare them to be ministers, because the king and many of his nobles are extremely observant religious leaders of the accursed sect. And the most important ones are so taken in by the ministers of this false sect that the kings do not undertake anything of importance without taking counsel from them. Not coincidentally, given the commercial cooperation that existed between Muslim rulers and both Jewish and Protestant traders, Father Alvarez also bemoaned the loss of trade on the Northern Petite Côte to French pirates. Further south in the frontier, while upstate of Baalambaya, Father Alvarez noted a recent political change that may have had a negative impact on the Jewish merchants settled there. There was a new king, a 23-year-old named Decipher. Unlike his father, who had so forcibly protected his Jews against a delegation of Portuguese Catholics, Decipher was not a Muslim. Alvarez described him, "He is a very good friend of the Portuguese." The clear implication is that Portuguese Catholic traders who were Alvarez's informants were happier with Decipher than they had been with his predecessor, and that they hoped the young king might change the previous policy of protecting Northern European traders and their Jewish allies. According to Father Alvarez, the Bercian, or Ray, the king of Bercium, sought to control trade from his river port of Joal and not from the coast, where attacks of pirates took place. He asked that Bercian was not interested in an alliance with the Northern European traders, though he still traded with them. Unlike the father of Decipher in the neighboring polity of Baalambaya, who in the deprecating discourse of the Jesuit was mainly guided by private profit and not by friendship with the Portuguese. As we have seen, 1612, the diplomatic intervention of the teen had played a crucial role in protecting the Jews from the Catholic groups of Cachao. The Jews' quest for religious common ground with the Sarir king, whom the Inquisition sources described at the time as a Muslim, or at least surrounded by a Muslim council, helped to maintain that political protection. This dynastic succession, together with the fact that there was now an increased volume of seaborne trade between Joal and the Portuguese trading center in Cachao, brought a greater commercial competition as well as an increased danger of further visits from emissaries of the Inquisition. The new ruler of Porto de Al might prove less inclined forcibly to protect the Jewish merchants should such visits ensue. The loss of Islamic influence on Joal would probably, therefore, have been a disturbing element for the Jewish merchants settled there. In this changing political environment, some of the Sephardic merchants may have decided to move the base of their operation from Joal to Porto de Al, where it was still possible to be a public Jew and openly dispute religious matters. Even in 1630s and 1635, when Gaspar Diaz Robalo arrived in Joal from Cachao seeking the promised land, he felt a tense environment when he publicly asserted his Jewish identity. Ultimately, it may well be that gradually deteriorating relations with the local ruler, quite possibly associated with declining profits from the hides trade, helped to influence the decision of several members of the Petite Côte community to return to the Netherlands. That was not the case of Gaspar Diaz Robalo, already an old man, when he traveled from Cachao, where he purchased slaves, to Joal. Subsequently, he found his spiritual destiny in Porto de Al. He was circumcised there by Manuel Peregrino and died of the injuries of his, or of the illness he got during the travel. He received a Jewish burial in West African soil. The return to Amsterdam. In early 1635, a French friar, Alexis de St. Lô, spent time preaching and converting on the Petite Côte. One day in February of that year, evidently in the trading village of Port d'Al, St. Lô wrote, "We went to visit a Jew named Peregrine, who is like the doctor of all the other Jews who live on the coast. We had barely arrived in his house when he had brought out a Bible and began a disputation on the time of the coming of the Messiah." This Peregrino, we know from the Inquisition sources of 1630s, was not Jacob, but his son Manuel. In Porto de Al, Father de St. Lô claimed that there were only three or four Jews. It is clear that the Jewish community had decreased markedly in size. St. Lô also visited Joal, where he did not observe a single Jewish family in the neighboring towns of Refisque. There were two families of Jews. Aside from Peregrino, the other individuals were either Africans or Africans, and some of them had been converted by Peregrino. This conversion of Africans to Judaism had continued from the early days of the Petit Coast settlements. In 1646, a report by Spanish Capuchines asserted that there were 22 Jews living in Rufisque. All belonged to single extended families consisting of a European merchant and his wife, children, and household retainers, among whom were 8 slaves. Clearly, the slaves were African. Whether the retainers and children were Africans or young Africans is not stated. But the earlier Portuguese patterns is still followed of converting servants to one's own religion. By 1635, Juan was no longer an important settlement for public Jews in Senegambia. The role played in this development by the dynastic succession of religious change in Lambaya on the southern Petit Cote is difficult to assess. This is because other factors also played a role in the decline. Ironically, one of these factors was the commercial success of many of the original Jewish settlers. The wealth that several of the Petit Cote merchants acquired through trade in hides and ivory enabled them to return to Amsterdam. There, in the course of the 1620s, they established themselves as investors in commercial voyages not only to Africa, but also to the Azores, Brazil, and the Indian Ocean. The Jewish merchants of Petit Cote had numerous reasons to return to Amsterdam. The creation of the Dutch West India Company in 1621 led Jews from Cape Verde, probably Rufisque, to the use of ships of the company as means of transport for their merchandise off the books. We do not know if a similar pattern of transportation was followed by their co-religionists in Porto Real. This situation of parallel trade enabled outsiders to profit from the ships of the company. A decision of the WIC on April 21st, 1636 outlawed the practice. We know that shortly thereafter, in about 1639, 1641, another factor radically diminished all European business in the rivers of Guinea. A great famine was caused by a plague of grasshoppers. These conjunctural reasons, combined with the local issues described below, help to explain the decline of the communities at Joal and Porto Real. Many Jews had left family members, including sisters and parents, in Amsterdam. This is made clear by the survival of letters written to the men by close family members. The letters which were captured somewhere between Europe and West Africa, are preserved in the archives of the Lisbon Inquisition. The decision of the men to travel alone to Africa may initially have reflected uncertainty about the safety and the commercial viability of the new settlements at Joal and Porto Real. But later events suggest that some of them never intended to settle permanently in Senegal. Several of the merchants returned definitely to Amsterdam by the mid-1620s, Bondia, Mesquita, Cardenero, Gaspar Fernandez. In addition, circa 1644-1646, Pedro Rodriguez, under the name of Abraham Toro, was in Rotterdam or Amsterdam. Diogo Vaz de Sousa continued to travel back and forth, but he was still mentioned on the Petit Cote in 1633. In that year, a report from the Bishop of Santiago mentions him, along with Geronimo Gomez and 2 other men. They were living as public Jews in Porto Real. Most of the other traders named in the initial Inquisition reports of 1612 do not appear either in the records of the Gabinete Archive or in the Inquisition archives after 1619, so it's hard to trace them. Some certainly stayed on the Petit Cote because after Jacob Emmanuel Peregrino again left Amsterdam, where they are documented in 1619 and 1620, Manuel served as a ritual leader of the Jewish community of Senegal in the 1630s, indicating that he retained a clientele there. Confirmation of St. Lowe's report comes from a reference in the Livro de Bethlehem to one Jacob de Sousa, returned from Guinea in about 1645. With this name, the person in question could only be a son or close relative of Diogo Vaz de Sousa, Omoco or Velho, one of whom was still in Porto Real in 1635. For these men who did return to the Netherlands after a decade in West Africa, both Amsterdam and Rotterdam offered significant financial and religious advantages, as well as social opportunities that included families, marriage and families. Most importantly, Amsterdam by 1620 was home to a thriving and rapidly growing Sephardic population. The original Jewish immigrants to the city had arrived shortly after 1590. By the time that Joao Salerno's group of Portuguese Dutch Jews arrived on the Petit Cote, the population of Amsterdam had increased to an estimated 500, reflecting reflecting the 1609 truce between Spain and the United Provinces, and the resulting continued immigration from Iberia and Morocco. Already by 1608 and 1609, there were two Sephardic congregations in the city. By 1620, there were an estimated 1,000 Sephardic Jews living in Amsterdam. By 1675, when an imposing new synagogue still in use today was dedicated, Amsterdam Portuguese community numbered around 2,800 individuals. This compared to the two small synagogues and a total Jewish population in João Porto Real of somewhere between 15 and 24 households. The households and synagogue consisted of European men that converted African servants and an unknown number of African consorts. Largely anecdotal information from the late 17th century provides additional evidence that some of the settlers on the Petit Côte fathered children by local women. This evidence comes from Senegal. Further evidence in Amsterdam indicates that some of his offspring in question did move to the Netherlands. For example, on May 4, 1647, the Book of Bentheim registers the following burial. On the 4th of the May, the Lord took the On the 4th of May, the Lord took to himself a girl, the daughter of the mulatta Katamsa, who lives in the house of Davivas named Sarah. And she was buried near the tomb of the black woman, Gracia, who was of the house of Judah Toro. We do not know if this Vas is related to the Vas de Sosa family, but Judah Toro was the Jewish name of Gaspar Fernandez Viega, a member of the Rodriguez Viega family. The situation described with black and mulatto servants living in the houses of the Jews dates to the early 17th century. If the mentioned mulatta and her deceased daughter were offspring of a Jewish African union, this would be evidence of Euro-African families who returned to the United Provinces. The individuals mentioned in the later travel accounts from the Upper Guinea coast are either the descendants of the merchants who remained there, Jacob de Sosa, or they themselves stayed in Senegal after their fathers returned to Northern Europe. Such was likely the case of the Fulano de Mesquita. It appears that the merchants who did not remain on the Petit Côte waited to establish families with respect at least to the offspring who would become their legally recognized descendants until after they returned to the Netherlands. Amsterdam offered a far greater range of commercial possibilities than did the Petit Côte, especially for those men who, like Diogo, Martins Bandia, and Moses de Mesquita, had enjoyed business success while in Senegal. On the other hand, those who had suffered financial reverses or even judicial problems, such as Jacob Pellegrino, not only were unable to benefit from the greater investment possibilities in Amsterdam, they were at risk of being pursued in court for their debts. They consequently were the individuals most likely to remain in or to return to Senegambia. It was common for young adult men from Sephardic mercantile families to begin their business careers by a stint, often a long duration, in distant ports of the commercial diaspora. There they could pick up practical experiences and language skills that would be useful to the extended family commercial network. This situation followed the general pattern of Portuguese trading families with regard to the geographical distribution of responsibilities according to the hierarchies of age and know-how. The business apprenticeship and the skills the young traders acquired were particularly important in the context of a newly forming immigrant community. This, of course, was exactly the situation of the first generation of Jewish immigrants in early 17th century Amsterdam. Those individuals who, through good fortune of extraordinary talent, succeeded in amassing a nest egg during their years on the West African coast, subsequently, after returning to the commercial and financial hub, entered into potentially more lucrative ventures, often financing other merchant trading voyages. In 1620, one of the Petit Coast merchants, Diogo Martins Bandia, was part of a large group of investors who financed a trading voyage to Bahia. In 1626, he underwrote half of the cost of a voyage to Terceira and the Canary Islands. This also suggests that Bandia may have been part of the transatlantic commercial network that connected to Sao Tome in Brazil with all of his investments, outfitting numerous voyages to Brazil and North Africa in collaboration with other members of the Portuguese communities in Amsterdam and also in Hamburg. Bandia appears to have become relatively wealthy by the 1630s when he was in his 50s. significantly, and at least one of his later investments was closed or secured by Gaspar Duarte Fernandez Viega, the former and another member of the Petit Coat community, and his brother, who by that time, 1626, were both living in Rotterdam. Clearly, veterans of the early settlements in Senegal established bonds of trust that endured long after most of the members, the Joao and Porto Dial communities, returned to the Netherlands. Of the original Portuguese name, the Inquisition reports about Joao and Porto Dial, only one is known to have died before 1620. At least two of the settlers, the Rabbi Jacob Pellegrino and his son Manuel, were still living primarily in Senegal in the 1620s. Dutch notary archives from 1620s to 1630s indicate that at least four veterans of the Petit Coast settlements maintained professional and financial connections with one another after they returned to the Netherlands. It is likely that other individuals were involved, but the records of their shared transactions have been lost or are cataloged somewhere other than in the notarial archives. These ties certainly reflect a high level of mutual trust, conceivably an enduring feeling of a community that developed through the shared experiences in Senegal. This feeling was reinforced by the fact that a number of members were bonded by a double link, family and business. That was the case of the Pedro Rodriguez da Viega and his brothers. Not all of the relationships between veterans of the Petit Coat, however, were characterized by trust. In 1619 and 1620, a scandal involving both personal and financial accusations reached the Amsterdam courts, ironically involved charges against Jacob Pellegrino, the rabbi of the Senegalese community, and his son Manuel. This affair, which is discussed in an article by Tobias Green, pitted the Pellegrinos against a group of wealthy Jewish financiers, including Diogo Diaz Querido, Fernando Alvarez de Melo, and Diego Nunes Belmonte. Querido and Belmonte were supported by Jorge Fernandez Carnero, an original member of the Petit Coat community, and by a later arrival at Joao Daniel Belmonte. Manuel Pellegrino was accused of seducing a young woman in Amsterdam community with an implicitly spurious offer of marriage. Daniel Belmonte cast further aspersions on Manuel's character by reporting that in the Senegal, the rabbi's son had seduced the daughter of the King of Walla. The daughter, regardless of the merits of the charges against Manuel, the accusations appear to have been aimed partly at discrediting his father. As Tobias Green has argued, Jacob Pellegrino, in addition to serving as Rabbi and Joao in Porto Real, was also a merchant working in the service of Querido and his associates. And Querido accused him of not having made full payment for the financial gains of two voyages in 1611 and 1612. Given the small size of the Jewish community on the Petit Coat and the potentially significant profits from the hide and ivory trade, it is hardly surprising that all the members of the community were actively involved in commerce. The fact that Belmonte and Querido were pursuing this case in 1620, 8 years after Jacob Pellegrino's purportedly shady financial dealings, suggests that something had caused the case to be postponed. Most likely the reason was Pellegrino's continued absence from Amsterdam while living on the Petit Coat. This was his first extended trip north since 1612, although he apparently made a brief voyage to Europe. Also subject to litigation in 1613, Pellegrino's legal troubles may reflect the fact that, as he himself argued in his own defense and as Green observes, that the rabbi had been plagued by financial bad luck. These troubles may well have played a role in his decision to return to Senegal. This case, however, also makes abundantly clear the fact that the Jewish community on the Petit Coat was not free of internal conflicts. These disagreements range from financial matters to issues of personality. The fact that Rabbi was directly involved in even the subject of one of the conflicts further suggests that even though their religion provided the foundation upon which the men of Joao Porto Real came together in the first place, and even though they did unite as Jews in the face of common threats from the Inquisition, their shared religious identity did not guarantee cooperation or even domestic tranquility. Whereas the Pellegrinos did not become wealthy, at least during the first 8 years in Senegal, others such as Bondia did thrive. An even more impressive example of one who, as a young man, had settled on the Petite Côte, but who later achieved wealth and a high status within the Sephardic community of Amsterdam, is Moses de Mesquita. By 1622, he had left Senegal and moved permanently to Amsterdam. There he married and started a family in spite of the family tragedy, the loss of an infant daughter in 1622. At some point in the next decade, he offered a Torah scroll belonging to him to Bet Israel, Senegal. There are two ways in which Mesquita may have offered this scroll. It takes a full year's work for the scribe or Sefer Torah to make a new Torah. During this time, the donor must pay the scribe an entire year's salary. If Mesquita did this, it is evidence that already before 1635, he was a very wealthy man. The second possibility is that he already possessed a copy of the Torah. If this was the case, then it was very likely the Torah from Joal. By the 1620s, when many of the original settlers from 1608 to 1612 now settled in Amsterdam, there would no longer have been need for two synagogues in Senegal. One Torah would have been inadequate for Jacob and Emmanuel Pellegrino after their return to the Petite Côte. Moses de Mesquita's social standing and his wealth continued to grow. In 1647, he elected community Parnas. In that year, he was also one of the seven signatories of the Ordinance of the Amsterdam Synagogue. He was elected community Parnas again in 1660, and in 1663 was selected as Hatan Torah. This is a high donor. On the Jewish holiday of Simchat Torah, the reading of the Pentateuch is completed and the congregation then immediately begins anew with the reading of the beginning of Genesis. The Hatan Torah, there are two of them, reads the end of the old cycle in front of the congregation or the beginning of the new cycle. In 1664, Mesquita became Parnas of the Bikor Halim Society, charged with visiting the sick. At the time of his death, at the age of 91 in 1680, he had amassed a considerable fortune, which he and his wife bequeathed to several relatives. For men such as Moses de Mesquita, the years spent on Petite Côte provided an opportunity to develop the skills and contacts, as well as to amass financial resources that made possible their later success as investors and that facilitated their rise to the positions of prestige within the Amsterdam's Jewish community. The years they had spent as young men in Senegal also enabled them to establish trusting commercial relationships with each other and with older, already established members on the Amsterdam Portuguese community. Men such as Diogo Dias Canedo, Mesquita, for example, developed close ties with wealthy and prominent Belmonte family. In 1677, he was in his late 80s. He presented his nephew David in marriage to Leah, the granddaughter of Jacob Belmonte, one of the wealthiest members of the Amsterdam community. Important as the time of Joao and Porto de Alva was to his later achievements, it is likely that when Moses de Mesquita arrived on the Petite Côte 65 years early, he did not intend to settle permanently in West Africa. All right, let's get to the skin color and social status portion of the book. Amsterdam Jews and attitudes toward skin color and social status. In Amsterdam, there was a significant population of Jewish servants of color, as well as Euro-African Jews, the offspring of earlier intermarriage. The presence of both African and Euro-African Jews coincided with a critical period for Northern Europe in the evolution of conceptual categories based primarily on skin color. Stopping there, you know what Afrocentrics and BHI employ? You got that from Europe. I'm just wanting to let you guys know, you got that concept from Europe. And you love that concept, and you enforce that concept, and that you live by the confines of that concept, right? Just want to remind everybody, right? That people that still choose to use this very racist and dubious categorization of humans. Anyway, it says here, it says the presence of both African and Euro-African Jews coincided with a crucial period for Northern Europe. With a crucial period for Northern Europe in the evolution of conceptual categories based primarily on skin color, and ultimately in the growth of a hierarchical system for categorizing human beings according to their physical appearance. This hierarchical and increasingly rigid system gradually evolved in the 18th and 19th century into the broadly shared, formalized racism that came to characterize Europe and North American society. Historian Jonathan Scorch, in his study of Jews and Blacks in the 17th century, rejects the historical interpretation according to which racism is seen as largely a product of the Enlightenment, he writes. This always under construction set of notions about peoples and their differences existed long before the Enlightenment origins, usually assigned to racism by scholarship. It is certainly true that disparaging attitudes towards Blacks had become prevalent in Dutch society and English and French society as well by the end of the 17th and the early years of the 18th century. And Scorch is correct to trace the roots of these attitudes in an even earlier period. However, 16th and early 17th century attitudes toward Africans are complex and varied and often contradictory. Among Jewish settlers who returned to Amsterdam from the Petite Côte, comportment and attitudes toward darker-skinned members of their own community were generally quite positive. So at the onset, the Jews accepted the darker-skinned members, whether they be offspring or converts. So everybody that's losing their mind behind this, you got to understand that there was an ideological shift, right? Very ideological shift, and we're going to get into that. I'll be right back. Let me take a brief intermission real quick.
Keep it real with your dog no matter what. Preach. Same bitch decline, she love you, she'll set you up. Preach. Out here in these streets, it ain't no such thing as love. Preach. The only thing I trust is this pistol and these slugs. Preach. Real nigga shit, only when I do speak. If that nigga don't work, he'll fucking leech. Preach.
All right, I'm back. So let's get into this. Anyway, it says here, furthermore, the earliest religions and civic legislation that was intended to establish the social status of Blacks and to regulate their interrelation with Europeans itself sometimes ambiguous and even contradictory. In Amsterdam, there was not a linear evolution of racial attitudes and legislation. In addition, there is a matter of definition. What specifically is meant by racism? If one means a widely shared propensity to disparage or devalue a group of human beings because of their complexion, then racism may, as Scorch suggests, be traced to an earlier period. This general propensity must not be confused with the gradual and historically contingent construction of representation based on physical features as markers of social and moral identity. Furthermore, one also attends by the term and articulated in more or less cohesive intellectual or pseudo-intellectual classification system. Classification system of human beings, together with the more or less cohesive intellectual or pseudo-intellectual and philosophical rationale for this system, then racism is indeed a product of the Enlightenment. This broad cultural development encompassed all segments of the European population, Christians as well as Jews. Scorch has suggested that Jews felt themselves to be especially vulnerable to the incipient racial consciousness in Dutch society because their own status as whites had not been firmly established. This is an interesting theory, one that offers insight into a series of regulations that were passed by the members of the Sephardic community toward the middle of the 17th century, and that they may help to explain why Jews in that city gradually established a hierarchy within their community based on or closely associated with skin color. He theorized that the Dutch Sephardim imposed increasingly restrictive regulation on Black and Euro-African Jews with regard to participation in religious rituals ranging from burial practices to activities within the synagogue, precisely in order to establish their own identity as whites. In the mid-17th century, the Portuguese Jewish community of Amsterdam instituted a series of communal ordinances that reflected and constructed the desired racial transformation of Jews by gradually excluding non-white Jews and white slaves from slaves from participation. Now, real quick commentary on this as well. That lets you know that the Jews during this time, this explains a lot of the writings of Jews during this time, like especially the Portuguese Jews being seen as being dark. No, that is not a metaphor. That is talking about somatically, somatically meaning in physical appearance. Their skin were dark. They were brown. They were dark. And they were trying, a lot of these European Jews were trying to distance themselves from that, right? Because they wanted to fit in with the new ideology. The new ideology was, you know, the racial hierarchical system with white on the top, black on the bottom. So these Jews started to be extremely racist and prejudiced towards their own children, their own members, right? Their own relatives, and trying to distance themselves from that so they can be accepted as hyphenated white or white. It says here there is surely some validity to this argument, but the historical narrative is overly schematic. The end result of establishing a racial social hierarchy would only have been apparent after the fact. Scorch's narrative imparts a sense of historical inevitability to this process, partly through this anachronistic use of terminology, racial transformation. That is not entirely applicable to the mid-17th century Northern Europe. More precisely, there is a proleptic use of terminology pertaining to what subsequent generation would term race. The other is careful to place this term within quotation marks, thus acknowledging that the concept of race itself was not, in its modern connotation, part of the 17th century discourse of Portuguese Jews. Nevertheless, the assertion that religious ordinances constructed the desired identity transformation implies, indeed, explicitly states that the outcome of this long historical process, a small part of which is here detailed, was clearly intended result of a willed process. Important decisions such as restricting the definition of who qualified for full membership in the Portuguese Jewish religious community were based upon multiple considerations, not all of which pertain to asserting that members of this community were white. To give an example from the Hamburg Sephardic community, the prohibition from circumcising individuals who are not of Jewish descent dating to 1653 might appear to be a clear-cut instance of Jews applying the concept of limpeza de sangre. However, as Studman Halevi has demonstrated by reference to the ordinance itself, that regulation was put into effect because proselytizing of Christians by Jews aroused the enmity of Hamburg's civil authorities and placed the Jewish community in danger of reprisals. Such nuances were also characteristic of the 17th century regulation that gradually altered the role of African and Euro-African members of the Dutch Sephardic community. In order to avoid the anachronistic use of race as a concept for the mid-17th century, a period when it was not yet a widely spread operable notion, we would argue that Amsterdam Jews, like other Northern Europeans in the mid-17th century, were gradually developing conceptual categories that, under the influence, as Scorch convincingly argues, of the growing Atlantic slave trade, would ultimately constitute the system of racial categories that has characterized European and North American society since the Enlightenment. During the 1640s, measures were taken that suggest the beginnings of a color-based social hierarchy. The Muhammad passed a series of measures that appeared to exclude Black and Mulatto Jews from holding positions of authority within the synagogue. However, as we shall see, the very existence of such legislations reflects the fact that some Euro-African Jews did hold positions of authority. Quick sidebar here. That's why you get, I think there was a Jew in England that he was noted to be big and Black. He was a ruler of a synagogue. So he did have Black people in high positions in the Jewish community during that time, right? And what happens is you get these Afrocentrics that play by the racial hierarchical playbook. No, that can't be a person that's Black because, you know, Jews are all white because you're going off of the Jewish hierarchical the European hierarchical racial system that was gaining steam during this time. But as we can see, clearly we've been reading through this book, there were your African members and there were regular African members of the Sephardic Jewish communities. All right. It says other regulations appear to have prescribed specific areas of the Otterkirk Cemetery for Jews of African origin. Cemetery regulations, too, are somewhat ambiguous. In the cemetery, as Scorch observes, there was initially no separate place for African or your African Jews. In 1647, a separate area was assigned to them. However, as Dinke Hundius points out, the 1647 regulations allowed Jewish-born Blacks who were married to Broncos to be buried in the main part of the cemetery. Furthermore, this reversed a rule dating to 1627 that blacks had to be buried outside the cemetery. Finally, however, in 1682, the cemetery of Otterkirk did establish a separate section for blacks. The sequence of rule changes suggests that the development of racial segregation within the Amsterdam Sephardic community was a hesitating, even an ad hoc process that reflected as much of the realities of the 17th century racial mixing of the incipient segregation. Again, as Hondius observes, the 1647 cemetery regulation demonstrates an official acceptance of the marriages that occurred between black and white Jews in Amsterdam. The conversion of Africans showed an openness to accepting darker-skinned members into the community. How common was this practice? Diogo Dias Querido, one of the most prominent and wealthiest members of the Amsterdam community, converted some of his servants who served as trading agents. This reflects a practice that was widespread among all Portuguese in West Africa, Christians as well as Jews. In Senegal, conversion of Africans to Judaism is documented on several occasions, including in 1624 and again 1635. Jonathan Scorch argues that in Amsterdam, such cases constituted a small minority. He bases his argument in part on a source that states Querido attempted to convert even the slaves up to the Jewish faith. However, contrary to the implication in the text, the source he quotes is not a 17th century document, but rather Coyne's 1972 biographical commentary on Querido. The racial attitudes toward conversion of slaves implied in the statement are therefore not 17th century, but late 20th century. By contrast, consultation of the registers of burials in Outerkirk Cemetery reveals the frequency of black and mulatto Jews and Portuguese Jewish households in Amsterdam. The passage of regulation by the Mahamad in the 1640s, although clearly discriminatory, reflects the complex and sometimes contradictory nature of the mid-17th century attitudes toward individuals of diverse heritage. In 1644, as Scorch observes, the community leaders banned Jewish blacks and mulattoes from performing any ritual role or receiving any honor. That is, they removed black participation from visibility in the synagogue. The decree is incontrovertibly discriminatory. In his analysis of these ordinances, he described the signatories. Many of the leaders at whose hands the exclusionary Amsterdam ordinance became official wrote the rise of commercial colonial ties of the Netherlands. These wealthy cosmopolitan Sephardic leaders in Amsterdam, many of them born and bred as Christians in Spain and Portugal, several of them merchants trading overseas. Among these wealthy and cosmopolitan merchants was one who was elected community parnas in 1647 and again in 1660. His name was Moses de Mesquita. Thus, one of the most prominent members of the Mahamad was himself a mulatto. Even at the moment when the council was passing regulations that limited the participation of African and Euro-African Jews in the religious life of the community, Mesquita, after his return to Amsterdam from the Petit Coat about 1620, became one of the wealthiest and most respected members of the Portuguese community. The fact that a Euro-African was elected to the Mahamad 3 years after the body had passed apparently exclusionary regulations illustrates a disjunction between the legislation and actual practice within the Jewish community at the mid-century. Throughout Northern Europe, among Christians as well as Jews, a sense of identity closely associated with and ultimately based in part upon physical characteristics is increasingly common by the late 17th century. The regulations put in place beginning in the 1640s by Amsterdam's Sephardic Jews reflect this wider historical development. For the Portuguese communities of Amsterdam and Hamburg, as Scorch and Stuman Halevi have demonstrated, the legacy of their own confrontation with the concept of limpeza de sangre was one important influence that led to the growth of an incipient color-conscious regard. Another factor was the context of Northern European urban and mercantile society. Nevertheless, within the Sephardic community of Amsterdam, the movement toward the establishment of social hierarchy based on skin color and descent was not without exceptions. Those exceptions, in turn, were the legacy of an earlier movement when the Portuguese and Luso-African Jews joined the community of exile in Senegal and in Amsterdam, a community that was not defined by discrimination based on physical characteristics. Early 17th century Portuguese Jews, and certainly those who settled in Senegal, did not discriminate Jews by skin color. Our analysis inverts previous historians' interpretation that in early 17th century Amsterdam, proselytizing of Africans and integration of them and their descendants into the Sephardic community was the exception and was viewed pejoratively. To the contrary, conversions of Senegambians was not an exception. The founder experience of the Mestizaje and conversions of Grumetes, wives, concubines, and descendants was standard practice. Among both Christian and Jewish Portuguese in the Cape Verde Islands and Guinea of Cape Verde. This practice was the result of 150 years of Portuguese settlement on the West African coast, and it predates the establishment of the Sephardic community in Amsterdam by 120 years. In Portugal, African and Euro-Africans constituted a small but significant portion of people of the nation. Some of these men migrated first to the Petitcoat and subsequently to Amsterdam. The two Jewish communities on the Petitcoat, with their continuous and close commercial and familial ties to the elite of the newly established communities in the United Provinces, exported this pattern from Guinea to Amsterdam. African and Euro-African Jews in Senegal, the later 17th century. So this segment is going to say what happened to the African and Euro-African Jews, which are obviously descendants of these European Jews as well. What happened to them? Where are they? For the second half of the 17th century, information about Jewish traders in Senegambia, or rather about their descendants, is scanty compared to the first two decades of the century. There is, however, no evidence of the development of a racialist hierarchy. This is not surprising. Most, if not all, of the later descendants of Sephardic traders and of new Christian Lakotos in Guinea of Cape Verde were themselves Euro-Africans who followed local identity models. These individuals did refer to themselves as white or bronco in the 17th century Senegambia. However, the term did not imply inherited social status, nor was it based on physical characteristics. For the descendants of Jewish merchants on the Upper Guinea coast, the situation was much different from which prevailed in Amsterdam in the mid and late 17th century. In Senegambia, skin color was not and have never been a priority category, although the sobriquet white or bronco, or as expressed in local languages, taobab, was a term of prestige. It referred not to the shade of one's skin, but rather to one's professional status as a trader and to one's presumed wealth. By the second half of the 17th century, the Jewish communities of Joal and Porto de Al had largely disappeared from the historical record, although mixed traits of Judaism were still observed by European travelers. The mixing elements from African and European religions was characteristic of the late 17th century Portuguese trading communities of Senegambia. This phenomenon was an indication of the cultural assimilation of small isolated communities of Luso-African traders and of the fluidity of cultural as well as ethnic boundaries in the greater Senegambia. In 1666, Nicolas Villant, Sieur de Belfond, sailed from Amsterdam to the Petitcoat. He visited Gore in Rio Fresca. Fusque was home to the third Jewish community to be established on the Petitcoat, but it was the longest lasting. However, by the time of his visit, it was two decades since the Jews there had benefited from the spiritual leadership of the Peregrino family. The resulting religious isolation fostered acculturation, which Vilhant describes. Vilhant's account suggests that the Jews who were still living in Rafiske in the 1660s were beginning to move away from close observance of Sephardic ritual. He singles them out as only approaching Jewish practice. This strongly implies the beginning of a process of syncretism between Judaism and the other religions. And this, I'm going to stop here and give commentary. This is what I'm trying to tell you guys. Like a lot of people that use this book, have invoked this book, my brother Rob Bourne on here, they don't mention this part. Again, the Jews got there, they had children, they converted locals. But he doesn't mention the part, or they don't mention the part, rather, that the Jews started to absorb the culture of the locals. Right? They started to syncretize. That's why this guy that went out there and witnessed them during this time period could see that they were more and more acculturated during this time. It says here, by the 1660s, according to the Portuguese merchant Lemos Coelho, Jewish identity was no longer being transmitted to Luso Africa, descendants of the Pitiko trading communities. About Rafiske, he stated, many Portuguese whites live there in large houses, and many Portuguese who have declared themselves as Jews, as well as other houses that belong to Jews from the north, living in liberty with the king's support, who also protects them, and they have left their children of the land, Jews like themselves, by African women. If nevertheless, in my time, by God's mercy, they were all converted to the Catholic Church and today live as sons of the church. Lemos Cojejo's disparaging attitude toward these Luso Africans relates both to their Jewish heritage and to their status as mulattoes. There are only a few mestizos. Lemos Cojejo is deeply influenced by the Iberian notion of limpieza de sangre. However, people see what they want to see. The French traveler Jacques, writing nearly two decades after Lemos, presents quite a different picture. His account suggests that there were still practicing Jews in Senegambia. The fact that La Mer was a surname of a number of Jewish families in the 17th century, France, suggests that Jacques La Mer may himself have been of Jewish descent. He may therefore have been trusted by members of the local Jewish community as one of their own. And the changed constellation of political and commercial relations that prevailed more than 60 years after the heyday of the Amsterdam Jewish settlers of Dwaal, it is reasonable to assume that members of the coastal Jewish community would have felt safer divulging their religious identity to him than to the more hostile Lemos, an agent of the Portuguese crown. Lemos' account is confirmed by the experience of the French merchant Michael Jean Lolet, who traveled through the Gambia in 1685 at Vintang near the trading community of Garegia, La Corbe, observed that most of the Portuguese or Luso Africans were Jewish. Over the course of the next century, the Euro-Africans in Senegambia would become increasingly enculturated. Eventually, the descendants of Christians and Jews alike developed beliefs and ritual practices that were more closely identified with local Ghanaian rituals than with the two important religions of the book. Again, that's what I was trying to tell you guys about. A lot of these descendants pretty much just got absorbed by the locals and start practicing the same thing that the locals practice. On a petite coat, by the 19th century, the descendants of the Luso Africans no longer had access to visits from a rabbi, nor even from a Catholic priest. When the Abba David visited Joao in the 1840s, he found the inhabitants practicing a syncretic religion that was only vaguely tinged by half-remembered Christian rituals. Bolat, who had himself been born in Joao, was a priest, so he may have been less aware of the presence and remnants of Jewish faith. He reported no evidence that any Jewish ritual survived in Joao. He observed that the people of Joao maintained a sense of their distinctive identity. However, this identity took the form primarily of endogamy, which was closely associated with their sense of being Christians. No historical memory seems to have remained of their descent, their distant Sephardic origins. And this goes to another point. Here's some more commentary for you guys. Another point is people say, oh, if you don't practice the culture, don't have a cult. If you're not 100% Judaism, if you don't practice one of the European Jewish sects, if you're not Sephardic by ritual or practice or Ashkenazi, blah, 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 then you can't be a Jew. You can't claim that lineage. That's BS. It has nothing to do with it. Culture and descent is two different things, right? Culture and biology are two different things. They're not mutually exclusive. As we can see, these people clearly have Sephardic descent. But by the 1800s, 1900s, they no longer practice that way. They did not keep the Sephardic rites and rituals. That does not eliminate their ancestors. Let's keep reading. Joao and Porto Real, unlike the nearly contemporary settlements of Dutch Jews in Brazil or the later settlements in Suriname and Jonas Savani, were not agricultural communities. This was, of course, true of all Portuguese settlements, old Christian as well as new Christian and Jewish. On the Upper Guinea coast, yet unlike Joao and Porto Real, a few Portuguese trading escales in Guinea, including Cachao and Ziguincor, did become permanent settlements. Crucial to the long-term survival of Cachao and Ziguincor was the evolution of Creole or Luso African populations. These populations, which characterized 17th century Portuguese trading towns throughout coastal Guinea, of Cape Verde were the results of significant intermarriage between European merchants and local African women, and in subsequent generations between their African offspring and other African and Luso African traders. As we shall see in the concluding chapter, some of the Jewish merchants on the Petit Côte also left behind Creole descendants, but the original communities, at least as initially defined by their shared Jewish religious identity, no longer existed by the end of the 17th century. All right, so that's the last chapter. We're going to get into the conclusion and finish the book. Right? We're going to finish this book. So, that being stated, I got a word from our sponsors. Let's get a word from our sponsors in before we wrap this book up, man. You understand? Let's get a word from our sponsors.
Butterfly in the sky, I can go twice as high. Take a look, it's in a book, a reading rainbow. I can go anywhere, friends to know and ways to grow, a reading rainbow. I can be anything. Take a look, it's in a book, a reading rainbow.
Let's finish this book, man. We 216 pages in. Let's get it. Conclusion. Visiting the coast of Sierra Leone in early 1667, the Frenchman Nicolas Villiot engaged a local grumete, or as a Frenchman called him, a Moor. A Moor to carry him by boat along the Atlantic shore. Their small vessel was caught in a rough seas, and two men were in danger of drowning. The boatmen, however, managed to bring them safely through the perilous passage. As they reached shore, and as soon as he had brought the raft out of the waves and onto the beach, this local Moray paused and offered a prayer. Villiot writes, in a previous paragraph, the Frenchman describes the religion of the Sierra Leone as diverse. Some Africans have been converted by the Portuguese. To what religion, he does not say, but the reader may presume Catholicism. And the remainders were Mohammedan and idolaters. He makes a general observation that the inhabitants worship certain extravagant figures they name fetishes. However, he does not directly comment on the fact that three patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, are associated not with Islam or even specifically with the Catholic faith of most grumetes. Rather, he leaves it to render to make the association to Judaism. This anecdote bears another meaning for history of Portuguese and Dutch settlement and commerce in 17th century Upper Guinea. It strongly implies that Villiot's boatmen had a direct connection to either to new Christian Lankados or to Jewish merchants settled on the Upper Guinea coast. This connection is not surprising. All of the Guinea of Cape Verde was linked both by land and river corridors, as well as sea routes. Trade between Sierra Leone in the south and the Petite Côte in the north was crucial to the Atlantic commerce within the coastal circuit. Merchandise like cola, indigo, and ivory from the southeastern part of the coast was exchanged for cloth, cotton, and other goods coming from northern Senegambia or from Cachao. The participation of the Sephardim of the Petite Côte in the circuit implied travel and partnership with Africans and Luso Africans in Sierra Leone. Close collaborators of the Sephardic merchants were sometimes converted to Judaism. Trade routes were vital for the spread of this religious influence, just as networks of long-distance Manding or Jula merchants had long been crucial to the spread of Islam in coastal Senegambia. So too, it would appear, although on much a smaller scale, Sephardic merchants left a legacy of Jewish or Judaizing individuals or even communities. and trading centers where they had regular contact along the Upper Guinea coast. Was the boatman in Villiard's narrative the descendant of Luso African Jews who, through two generations of isolation from European Jewry, had evolved a syncretic fate? Such religious practices, combining local rituals and faith in indigenous spirits with elements of Western religion, were characteristic of isolated communities of Luso African Christians at the end of the 17th century. When his boatman tells Villiard that his murmured praying, evoking Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob as a way of offering thanks to his fetish, he clearly uses the fetish in the sense of spiritual force. If one interprets a fetish as his god, then the African's behavior takes on vague elements of Jewish prayer. However, the brevity of this passage does not provide enough information to confirm the interpretation of the fetish in an almost deistic manner. Parenthetically, the syncretic nature of this prayer, with its apparent reference both to the Jewish patriarchs and to the transcendent spiritual force that is conceptualized as a fetish, strongly suggests that a dynamic whereby local religion and elements of Judaism have here emerged. It is through the notion of communication with a superior or defined force that Abraham and Isaac come into play. In the problems of daily life, they are mediators to a divine force that thereby becomes directly involved in such mundane concerns as the safety of an individual man. These patriarchs may perhaps be seen as a spiritual bridge provided by the African's appropriation of isolated concepts that originated within Judaism. In other words, they serve as a boatman, as a means of direct communication with the transcendent. The appeals to West Africans, especially traders of Islam and Christianity, with their common notion of a supreme deity who is not always distant and removed from the affairs of humankind, has been the subject of an extensive literature. Our data, particularly for the later 17th century, while too scanty to warrant more than a hypothesis, suggests that the same dynamic may have occurred with Judaism. The presence on the Upper Guinea coast of diverse cultures whose members lived and transacted business in close proximity to one another is closely associated geographically and chronologically with the spread of Islam in the north, of Christianity near Cachao, and in the trading ports of Sierra Leone. And as our works now suggest, with the more limited dissemination of new Christian practices and with Judaism in those locations where Africans interacted closely with the nation. The literature on African conversion is most strongly marked by the theoretical framework provided by Robin Horton in two series of articles. Horton argues that Islam and Christianity religion centered on the notion of supreme being who serves as foundation of universalist moral order and who is not oblivious to our remote from the affairs of mankind, appealed first to Africans whose lives took them beyond the confines of local society. Hence, traveling merchants were among the first converts to Islam. More recently, Robert Baum has argued strongly that local religion, specifically the religion of the Isulalu Jola of southern Casamance, have the capacity to develop their own notion of a supreme deity who is directly involved in the affairs of man. As Baum shows, already during the pre-colonial period, some West African religions demonstrated the capacity to apply concepts of the supreme being to profoundly local affairs. Our study appears to confirm Baum's observation. Here's a syncretic African religion that, under the influence of Judaism or Christianity, or a mixture of the two, developed a cult that afforded direct access to a transcendent force or supreme being, as evidenced by the prayer which is addressed to the three Jewish patriarchs. The syncretic religious forms evidence here were the product not only of African Christian contact, but also of African Jewish interaction. The term fetish referred both to the amulets worn by Muslims and non-Muslims alike and to the spiritual forces which those charms invoked or represented, as well as to the shrines that embodied those forces and constituted a location for ritual offerings and prayers. The boatman is not described as offering his devotion at a shrine, nor does Villiard mention an amulet, but rather only the prayer. It therefore seems most likely that he is referring to a spiritual or transcendent force. Even if you were referring to an amulet, however, the episode will reflect a remote memory of the new Christian or Jewish prayer. Despite its pejorative connotations when used in a Christian context by Europeans, the word fetish was and sometimes still is used as a descriptive, but ostensibly not a pejorative term, even by the practitioners of local religions. However, the prayer described by Villard is atypical, even extraordinary, in its assimilation of a residual memory, not of Christian, but rather Jewish devotion. In this sense, it represents the remnants of a heritage that had reached from Senegal to Sierra Leone among Lakotos, whose descendants by the late 17th century no longer identified themselves as new Christians, and among Sephardic merchants based on the Petit Coat. The product of generation of metisage, or mixture, among the varied populations of local inhabitants and visiting merchants who frequented the Guinea of Cape Verde. Villard's boatman incorporates diverse identities in both his religion and his social status. To Villard, he is a Maori, an identification that would normally associate him with Islam and the long-distance traders with whom Europeans did business in Senegambia. As a boatman or grumete, he may be either African or Luso African. The appellation would normally imply that he is at least nominally a Christian. Yet the content of his prayer suggests that he is a Luso African with new Christian or Jewish antecedents. Villard's passage is tantalizingly brief and tells us nothing directly about the Moor's family history. The boatman's complex religious orientation were very likely constitutes evidence of the practice found among the Christian Lakotos during the 16th and early 17th century of introducing Judaizing rituals among their closest African collaborators. Nevertheless, we cannot exclude the possibility that he was a Luso African descendant of one of the Sephardic merchants who settled on the coast two generations earlier. The boatmen's religious identities are indisputably multiple. They are certainly confusing, and they may be a bit confused. The complexity of his religious identity reflects the long-term interaction of four diverse religious traditions among merchants, their family members, and their close assistants along the Upper Guinea in the two centuries after the arrival of the first Portuguese navigators. Yet this interpenetrating, syncretizing response to religious pluralism is also characteristic of and in some ways specific to Greater Senegambia. The episode recounted by Villard, coming at the end of the two centuries of Portuguese commercial and cultural preeminence among European visitors and settlers on the northern Upper Guinea coast, suggests that even in the late 17th century, we may speak of a Greater Senegambian model for constructing religious identity. Senegambia played a seminal role in the historical development of patterns of cultural interaction and mixing between Europeans and Africans. Even before the arrival of the Portuguese in the mid-15th century, Senegambian societies were characterized by flexible identities among different African peoples. This was especially true in the religious sphere, in part because Senegambia was the earliest region after the medieval kingdoms of the Sahel to be exposed to the Muslim region. Islam probably entered the Senegal River at the end of the first millennium CE. Coastal Wolof states as far as south as Petit Coat clearly had a Muslim elite by the time the Portuguese arrived. And as the present study has shown, by the early 17th century, Islam was also beginning to attract some of the Serer social and political elite. The Jewish religion, too, had early penetrated the Western Sahara from Morocco. Their Jewish and Muslim populations interacted, and as Prussian and Tavim have shown, some Berbers of Jewish origin were assimilated into the Muslim religion. But the distinctive Senegambian form of mixing extended to other areas of social and cultural interaction besides religion, especially to the closely related evolution of new cultural identities. The roots of this distinctive model of cultural interaction and identity formations are indigenous to the Senegambia. Portuguese Lakotos, when they settled on the coast, quickly adopted this local model. Indeed, the status of Lakoto itself is a product of Greater Senegambian society. The presence among the Lakotos of significant numbers of new Christians who readily fit into an already established structure of changing and contextually determined identities served more firmly to implant this model throughout the Guinea of Cape Verde. The Lakota presence confirmed the intercultural nature of Senegambian identity, and it set the stage for the establishment of Eurafrican communities. These processes of cultural interaction and identity building are key to understanding the early Atlantic world from Africa to Brazil. The historical analysis of specific instances of identity building in Guinea of Cape Verde provides insight into the first steps in the evolution of the New World. From the mid-15th century, the first contact between Africans and Europeans occurred in Great Senegambia. This region remained a laboratory for intercultural contact into the early 17th century. Indeed, it was there that commercial relations between African and Europeans developed, and that exchange networks grew to facilitate that commerce. Senegambia and the Cape Verde Islands also witnessed the growth of the earliest Luso African communities. These communities played a vital role in the commercial exchanges between European and Africans. In many respects, the Luso Africans of Guinea, of Cape Verde, were a prototype for subsequent Eurafrican communities, not only in West Africa, but also in Angola, as well as in South America. Before the arrival of the wave of Jewish traders from Lisbon and Northern Europe, the production of Luso African identity was centered in the Cape Verde Islands and Guinea of Cape Verde. These Jews and their partners, who had little or nothing to do with the Cape Verde merchant community, arrived at the rivers of Guinea and became rivals of the earlier traders, as Andre Alvarez de Almeida complains in the Lisbon manuscripts of his treaties. They also became a new parallel source of identity production. In a recent article about race and religion in the 17th century Cape Verde, Tobias Green argues that the Cape Verde Islands played a major role in the earliest articulation of identity models, especially Creole identity, for the Atlantic world. Green argues, as we do in opposition of Thornton and Haywood, that it was not Angola and Congo, but Upper Guinea that played a crucial role in the earliest articulation of these identity models. We extend Green's argument to include the mainland, specifically the Senegal River Valley and the coastal region as far as the Empire of Cabo in northeastern Guinea-Bissau, together with the northwestern Sierra Leone, what we together with Eduardo Costa Diaz termed Greater Senegambia, and emphasizing the formative role of Greater Senegambia together with the Cape Verde Islands, we would also point to the importance of historical primacy. The Senegambian coast, together with the Cape Verde Islands, provided the earliest theater for close and extended interaction among Africans, Europeans, and Eurafricans. Furthermore, the bulk of the slave trade to Spanish America before the foundation of Luanda and the growth of the trade from West Central Africa beginning around 1575 came from Upper Guinea. That's a highlight. Our study has focused on the contours and evolution of a Sephardic trading network linking Portugal, Northern Europe, Morocco, West Africa, and Brazil. That network made crucial contribution to the construction of the Atlantic world. Only recently has the role of Jewish identity been considered in construction of identities in the early modern Atlantic world. Critical to that historical development is the role of Judaism in the making of a Luso African identity. Yet concurrently, and for perhaps two generations, Senegambian society also played a role, if a minor one, in the reshaping of Jewish identity in Amsterdam. In the histories of identities in the Atlantic world, no region is more important than Guinea of Cape Verde. Although recent scholarship has argued for a similar role for West Central Africa, three factors suggest that the foundation for the intertwined destinies of Europeans, Euro-Africans, and Africans from Africa to the Americas were actually laid in Upper Guinea. First, Upper Guinea was the earliest locale for the construction of new Euro-African identities. Second, this region was unique in African Atlantic because here, from an early date, there was religious interaction between local African faith and Islam. This constitutes a crucial difference with West Central Africa and with Christianity and Judaism. The presence of Islam in Guinea of Cape Verde, with its long history of syncretism and interaction with local African religions, provided a template for the subsequent and more variegated interaction of Islam, Christianity, and Judaism, and local religions in Greater Senegambia. Third, the early 17th century Atlantic slave trade from Upper Guinea, as shown in Chapter 6, was three or four times larger than recent estimates by Eltis. Therefore, its relative importance in numerical terms must also be reassessed. The presence of new Christian and Jewish traders in late 16th and 17th century Guinea of Cape Verde and the story of their interactions with both the Wolof and Serres states of the Petite Côte and with individual Africans have significant implications for pre-colonial West African history. The broader importance lies in establishments of patterns of religious interactions and change in forms of social interaction and fusion. Equally significant are models of identity formation, especially with regard to Euro-Africans, that continue to characterize Greater Senegambia until the eye of the colonial period in the mid-19th century. With regard to the history of Judaism in the early modern period, the study has demonstrated the important role of new Christian Lakatos and Sephardic merchants in the process of integrating Senegambia and intercontinental commercial network. They and new Christian artisans based in Lisbon played a major role in the growth and important hitherto unknown system of production and trade of blade weapons to Upper Guinea. This seaborne Atlantic commerce was initially tied to trans-Saharan weapons trade to Morocco and before 1590 to Lisbon. Sephardic merchants, however, quickly redirected the commerce in weapons, hides, and ivory from Petite Côte to Rotterdam and Amsterdam, thereby playing an important part in the origin of a commercial network reaching from the Upper Guinea coast to Northern Europe. The tale of Sephardic merchants who settled on Senegal's Petite Côte between 1608 and about 1635 is a history that is intercontinental in scope. Their network almost immediately linked Senegambia to Brazil and Spanish America. The history of Jewish traders on Senegal's Petite Côte with their ties to North Africa, Iberia, Northern Europe, and South America constitutes a previously little known aspect of the Jewish commercial diaspora at the beginning of the 17th century. These settlements in a now obscure place in West Africa cast new light on the important role played by the Jewish and new Christian merchants in economic expansion of early modern Europe. Their history involved Europeans and Africans and joined them not only in commerce, but also cultural mixture and intermarriage. The relationship was based on a mutual openness to diverse peoples and on accompanying flexibility of identities. Characteristics of trade and traders in Greater Senegambia, all of this was possible circa 1600 in a way that would become impossible a century later. Their relationship in turn casts a new light on Jewish patterns of proselytizing and of intermarriage, and on the process of maintaining and recreating a sense of community and diaspora at a formative moment for the Jewish presence in Northern Europe. Indeed, a seminal moment for Jewish history in modern Europe. The settlements on Petite Côte and the Amsterdam sequel have significant implications for our understanding of the manner in which Jewish identity spread to Euro-Africans and for a brief moment to Africans. As long history of Portuguese and Senegambian interaction demonstrates, Euro-Africans could in a matter of a few generations be fully integrated into West African society. Similarly, Africans and Euro-Africans could be and were integrated into Portuguese society. And as the history of the Portuguese Jewish community shows, in the first half of the 17th century, Euro-Africans, and to a more limited extent, Africans could be integrated into Sephardic society in Amsterdam as well. We conclude with a short reflection on the paths our works followed. As new documents from the archives kept enlarging the scope, both thematic and geographical, of our subject, the interpretation of Senegambian and Luso-African history was crucial to establish a cross-cultural nexus with a broader and even global context. As our study of that history took us deeply into previously unexplored archival documents, the book became a portrait of individuals with names and family networks, first in Portugal and the Netherlands, but ultimately on four continents. We began by focusing on the Inquisition and church sources, but these led us to commercial records and to records of the Jewish community in Amsterdam. This in turn enticed us to follow the lives of real human beings, both through their individual deeds and by their membership in what seemed to us at first to be lost and marginal communities. Donald Wright, in his most important contribution to West African history, showed that a very small place in Africa, Niamey and the Gambia, could be intimately connected to the world. Similarly, we have come rather to our surprise to understand how another small place, two communities on Senegal's Petite Côte, through their role in the cultural, social, and economic dynamics of a larger place, the Guinea of Cape Verde, did ultimately really count in the history of the Atlantic world. These communities were not just a marginal space or a mere extension of externally determined processes. They were the locus for human experience that may have changed history, Jewish, West African, European, and Atlantic history. Like the inner circles of water that radiates from the first drops of rain on the surface of a lake, but that leads to larger and widening circles, this forgotten diaspora led us in widening circles first to Portugal and the Netherlands, then to Morocco, and finally to the broader Atlantic world. That is the book. We completed the book. That is the end of the book. That is the end of the book. That's the conclusion. So I will be putting all these videos in playlists. I appreciate everybody that you know, reached out, came out, and showed their support. I struggled with reading some of these pages because a lot of Portugal words are intermixed throughout this. And Peter Mark, man, you're going to have a problem because you need to stop doing that, man. Tongue twisters. Making my job harder than it need to be. But with that said, we learned a lot in this book. We learned about the trade, the Sephardic Jews, how they intermix, intermarried, and even Christians, how they intermix, intermarried with people that were in the coast, that were in Senegambia, Senegal, and surrounding areas, how the trade reflected the trades that happened earlier and in the Sahara. Whether it be slaves or iron or gold, wax, and ivory, especially ivory spoons, we learned about that. We learned about that the African children, the descendants of these Jews, they will remain, some of them will remain in West Africa and pretty much be absorbed into the other West African localities, either converted to Christianity or being completely absorbed into, African rituals. Which means their descendants are still there, which makes the Afrocentric argument stupid because these people didn't evaporate. They were not abducted by aliens. Shout out to Ron Dalton. They weren't abducted by aliens. They had children and continue to have children. I want to show y'all something real quick. We talked about the E1B1B markers and also J markers. But if you go to the J1M267, paper on J1M267. The origin of the fusion, here it is. If you go here, they give you a population spatial dispersion map. And what they want to know is, right, we got rid of it. I told you we're going to finish it, man. I'm about getting shit done. But you go to this paper, you can see some of these children still there to this day. So, you know, J1, there's no secret, J1P58 is a part of the European Jewish nexus. As you can see, J1P58 is in the west coast of Africa, right here. You see that pink there? So there's a considerable amount of J1P58 there. And this could be in relation to this European Jewish introgression. During the 17th and 16th centuries. You can see the little dot right there. Right, I think that's the coat of ivory there. This part of the map. Let me see what country that is. So I'm gonna rock with the Jewish history, man. Got more in common with Jews than I do Afrocentrics, I'll tell you that. But anyway, African country map. Images. What country is that? That's the Ivory Coast. That's on the Ivory Coast, which makes sense because these people were trading in ivory. You can see that there. They're also, I don't know if y'all can see it. Let me see if I can blow this thing up. No, it won't let me blow, but it's like a little sliver over here. But mainly over here in the coast, the Ivory Coast, which makes sense. See a J1P58 circle right there. All right, so with that being said, man, back to your regular schedule program. We knocked that book out. Peter Mark, you and I are going to have problems making me read Portuguese. Just put the shit in English, man. Don't make me hurt you. But anyway, for all the detractors out there, the book has been read live. My people are going to know if you bullshit. He said he speak the language, man. Well, you should have read it for me, brother. Exactly. He said, I don't know anyone reading books and educating their audience the way you do. I'm trying to find them so I can go, you know, I can take a break and go watch them. You know what I'm saying? We'll get back on some. There's some videos I got to go touch on, man. Unk made a video. We might review Chrissy Harris versus Yara. And we might do it a little later on today. But I will put all these videos in a playlist. So anybody want to go back and review them, they can. I think the book only like 10 bucks. That book is not that expensive that we just read. Things like 10 bucks. Anybody can get that book. It's an excellent book on, Safiq, I need help on that, man. I need help on that. It's like trying to read the Portuguese parts and then go back into the English. And it's a tongue twister, man. It's a tongue twister. But as we say, like, how I view it, man, Yap Brothers that were Jewish in Europe came down. Of course, J1P5 ate there as well. Then my brothers too, because at the end of the day, I got more in common with them than knuckleheads, you know, Afrocentric knuckleheads. We read about their experiences and whatnot. But also keep in mind, as we did a lot of work here on the channel to show that these people would have been a part of the original Jewish cluster to begin with, because all eight ethnic Jewish groups have a sub-Saharan African strand of DNA that connect them to the Yoruba and the Luya, which are largely E1B1A carriers, right? So when we make that claim of being ancient Israelites, it's very possible.
It's possible. It's possible. It's possible. It's possible. It's possible.
All right, we out. We'll be live a little later. Just got to figure out what the video might be about. We might do the review. I might be dealing with Aunt's crazy statements later. We'll see. Also, I swabbed for Family Tree DNA this morning. So you guys will see my Big Y results live. I'm going to air my Big Y results live on the channel. So if anybody's interested to see what the Big Y looks like, you're going to be able to see it on this channel. So again, we're here to educate you guys, you know. And just remember, in all not getting, get of understanding. We out. We out, man. Yeah.
I'm locked in with TP. We finna make a hit.
TP, baby.
Hey. Nigga come around me acting gangsta, I ain't buying it. He tried to run off, I dumped the Draco where he's buying it. 7-6 to God, I got that name because I'm fine it. Red, we live for life, post on the block, this where I'm dying it. If I shoot my gun, 300 shots gon' come behind it. And if I ever ran, the police probably was behind me. Been in corner, jumping fences, hitting them gates, and now we lit. Who can't do a show up in the city, bitch, this my shit. I'm sliding with 30, told them 50, sent 3 shots and bagged them up. Hey, you remember on that day I shot so fast to 50 bucks? No, you can't be the gang, you know it's hard for us to gain some trust. You wanna be the gang, you gotta sacrifice your life to us. I put a cap up on my head, no, I can't never go out burn. Think my shooter then went down for something, cause all he do is stir. My name spread like the coronavirus, shiesty in the earth. Kick the bitch up out the spot, I caught her trying to leave her hurt.
I put a cap up on my head, no, I can't never go out burn. Think my shooter then went down for something, cause all he do is stir. My name spread like the coronavirus, shiesty in the earth. Kick the bitch up out the spot, I caught her trying to leave her hurt.
Nigga come around me acting gangsta, I ain't buying it. tried to run off, I dumped the Draco where it's fine. 7 6 to God, I got that 9 because I'm fine. Red, we live for life, post on the block, this where I'm dying. If I shoot my gun, 300 shots gon' come behind it. And if I ever ran, the police probably was behind me. Been in corner, jumping fences, hitting them gates, and now we lit. Who can't do a show up in the city, bitch, this my shit. Popping out soon as dark, I been trapping all through the day. Shooter ready to spar, wait on they moment to spray. Cunzly burning these woods, I been smoking runs to the face. Styrofoam full of mud, my double cup mucha grape. Free my niggas from jail, if not, they might escape. Trafficking through the mail, make sure Mac come double tape. Pockets almost obese, I ain't trying to get them in shape. Might pop out in the hood, I'm familiar with all the J's. Slamming shit every day, bitch, we come from catching them plays. Catches that down bad, I'ma get them up out the way. Hit for like 35, caught them popping shit in the eight. Told them don't make a move, it's like 60 up in his drink. Nigga come around me acting gangsta, I ain't buying it. He tried to run off, I dumped the Draco where it's buying it. 7 6 to God, I got that 9 because I'm fine it. Red, we live for life, post on the block, this where I'm dying it. If I shoot my gun, 300 shots gon' come behind it. And if I ever ran, the police probably was behind me. Been in corner, jumping fences, hitting them gates, and now we lit. Who can't do a show up in the city, bitch, this my shit.
Whole bitty bitch. Brrr. Who gon' do it? Hey, 60 shots up in the chop, trying to hit 30, nigga. Hey, I'm big shots that I get dirty with you.